Good day friends, I'm Dr. S.K. Gupta and I'm going to discuss a case of oligohydramnios with you. I'm going to discuss with you what a sonologist should look for in a case of suspected oligohydramnios, how do we diagnose it, what are the other important conditions which can be associated and how can we guide the patient to improve the condition. This is a patient around 32 weeks of pregnancy. And she has come to us for a ultrasound examination, and you can see on the clinical assessment, on the eyeball assessment only, that the fluid in the abdomen and around various organs in this baby is pretty low. And those people who have been doing the ultrasound, they can assess by the eyeball examination only that the fluid around the fetus is pretty low. I'll show you another case of a similar gestation in which you can see that the fluid amount of fluid which is present at 32-33 weeks of gestation, whom you can see that the good amount of fluid can be seen around the baby, and there is good amount of fluid, amniotic fluid around various organs, and the echogenicity of the baby is nearly normal. And now I go back to the same case, our own case, where you can see that the fluid around the fetus is pretty low, and this is obviously a case of oligohydramnios. Oligohydramnios is diagnosed at 32 to 36 weeks of pregnancy when the amniotic fluid volume in four quarters around the fetus is less than 5 centimeters, or when the single depth volume is less than 3 centimeters. Some authors, they say 2 centimeters also, but we follow a criteria of 3 centimeters. Whenever you are not able to find the amniotic fluid around the fetus, you should always try to look for the amniotic fluid around the neck, because around the neck the amniotic fluid is generally maximum. But here in this case you can see that this is the head of the baby, and this is the body, and this is the neck. Here you can see that around the neck also the fluid volume is depth, or the total fluid volume is not more than 0.6 centimeters. So this is likely to be a case of oligohydramnios. When we measured the amniotic fluid all around in various quarters, we found that the amniotic fluid volume is not more than 4.5 centimeters in this case. Now, what are the causes of decrease in the amniotic fluid volume? There can be placental, there can be fetal causes, or they can be maternal causes. The ultrasoundologist is generally concerned with the fetal causes. Whenever you see that there is oligohydramnios, you try to look for two important things. One is the kidneys, urinary bladder, and secondly the cleft lip. Because kidneys produce the amniotic fluid beyond 20 weeks of gestation, and before the 10 weeks of gestation it is the maternal fluid which is released into the amniotic cavity and contributes maximum to the amniotic fluid volume. Another important condition is the cleft lip. In the patients with the cleft lip also, the amniotic fluid volume can go down because the fetus is not able to swallow any fluid, so the kidneys are not able to produce any urine and the amniotic fluid volume goes down. So we will try to look for these two important causes. The other causes of oligohydramnios can be the maternal causes like utero-placental insufficiency, preeclampsia, hypertension, or the leaking of membranes, or the post-date pregnancy. It is important to note that beyond 42 weeks of gestation, about 50% of the amniotic fluid volume goes down, and these babies may not be able to tolerate labor properly. It is also important to note that the hypertension or preeclampsia generally causes oligohydramnios, while diabetes in the mother causes polyhydramnios. And now you can see that this is the kidney over here, there was another kidney over here, and the urinary bladder is well seen. It means that kidneys are functioning normally, and we have to look for the other causes of oligohydramnios and try to show you the kidneys in the cross section also. And you can see that the kidneys in the cross section also, they appear to be normal. This is one kidney and this is another kidney over here. The kidneys appear to be normal. There is no hydronephrosis in the kidneys, and the urinary bladder is very well filled up. We are trying to show the color flow, the blood supply to the kidneys, and both the side the blood supply appears to be normal. This is one kidney on one side and this is kidney on the other side. The kidneys are taking up normal color. So there is no evidence of any problem in the kidneys. Sometimes the renal dysplasia or renal aplasia or renal agenesis may cause oligodramnios, but in this patient both the kidneys are well seen, bladder is normally filling, and even the urinary passage through the urethra appears to be normal because the bladder is getting emptied. This is the scan of the placenta. You can see that the placenta is normally made up. There is no spina bifida and the placenta thickness is nearly normal. At times the placenta might be thin, which may not produce enough blood exchange through the mother and the baby, and they may also give rise to oligodramnios, but in this case the placenta thickness is normal and the placenta appears to be normal. There is no abruptio placentae, and the retroplacenta space is normal, and the patient also does not give any history of leaking or rupture of membranes. So we have to look for the causes inside the fetus only. And let us try to look for the cleft lip, and this is the head of the baby. You can see this is these are the orbits and this is the nose. But because the acoustic window is very compromised because of the low amniotic fluid volume, so but we are not able to comment clearly whether the fetus is having cleft lip or not. It will be important to see the previous ultrasound done during the second trimester if there was any evidence of cleft lip or not, but she does not have any ultrasound done previously. Most of the patients with oligohydramnios may have IUGR because the placenta directs the umbilical cord directs the most of the blood to the brain, and the vital organs like kidney and the liver they suffer the blood deficiency because of the differential flow of the blood to the brain, and this is called brain sparing effect. Buffel AC ratio in this patient is nearly 28%, which is pretty high. And now because she is having IUGR, we are going to look for the effects of the IUGR in this patient. Now we'll perform the color Doppler scan for the uterine flow, the placental flow and the cerebral flow. This is the uterine artery on one side, and you can see that the uterine flow is nearly normal in the right uterine artery, and the resistance index is 0.42 and it is normal. And while on the left hand side we find that the resistance index is 0.7. There can be a difference of resistance index in both the uterine arteries because placenta is on the right hand side, so the flow on the right uterine is likely to be slightly higher, but overall we can say that the uterine flow to the fetus is normal. This is the color Doppler scan of the middle cerebral arteries, both the middle cerebral arteries beautifully seen, and now let us interrogate them by color. Normally the resistance flow index of the middle cerebral artery is more than 0.8, but here it is 0.73. On the opposite side also you can see that the resistance index of the middle cerebral artery is also low. Normally it should be more than 0.8, but here it is 0.66. So it appears that there is brain sparing effect, and the more of the blood has been diverted to the brain, giving rise to the low resistance. Now let us try to look for the flow across the umbilical arteries, and when we try to look for the umbilical vessels we find that the resistance index is pretty high over here. The resistance index in the umbilical vessels appears to be 0.75, which is more than the intracerebral vessels, that is middle cerebral artery. We try to interrogate it again, and we again here we find that the resistance index of the umbilical artery is high, suggesting the placental insufficiency or the decrease in the blood flow to the fetus by the umbilical arteries, giving rise to the IUGR. We find that the resistance index of the intracerebral vessels is less than the resistance index of the umbilical arteries, giving rise to a disparity in the cerebral placental flow, and this is suggestive of gross IUGR in this patient. Most of these patients are not likely to have a good prognosis. Now what can we do for these patients? These are the amino acid infusion solution. They can be infused in these patients, and if the mother is having hypertension, she can be treated for hypertension. That patients who receive ACE inhibitors, that is ramipril, captopril, these patients are likely to develop oligohydramnios more, and those patients who also receive non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, These drugs, they cause oligohydramnios, and these patients should be cautioned against the use of these drugs. But if the patient has come to us with the oligohydramnios, we can advise the mother to take more fluids. And some people, they give these solutions as IV solutions with better hydration, and it is supposed to increase the amniotic fluid volume in these patients. During labor, these patients, they can be infused amino acid solutions in the uterus by a uterine catheter, and these things are helpful during the labor because the fetus is able to tolerate the labor better. But if they are given prior to the labor, generally these patients, they develop oligohydramnios again after within 2 weeks. Advised to consume more and more water so that these patients, they can have a better amniotic fluid volume. But overall, these patients, they carry poor prognosis and they should be cautioned accordingly. I hope with this video you must have increased your knowledge about the oligohydramnios. In case you like our videos, please subscribe to our channel and do not forget to press the like button on the video and share the video with the large number of your friends so that maximum people can be benefited. Thank you very much.